Well, hello, and welcome to the Glenn Beck Program. Let's start with everybody's favorite topic, the one that everybody is talking about. How about a little Weiner? Congressman Weiner. Congressman Weiner headlines, come on. Love this. Blogger says he has X-rated photo involving Weiner. Weiner coached porn star to lie. Congressman to single mom. You're not stalking me. I'm stalking you. Weiner woman says Representative Weiner used government phone for phone sex. And my favorite is how Anthony Weiner can recover from this scandal. Most people know these stories. In fact, we have a studio audience. I asked this morning that we bring a studio audience in today because I want to ask about these headlines and these headlines. Everybody here probably can tell me all about the apology, the press conference, the timeline, the underwear pic, the cat pics, right? Who knows about the cat pictures? Anybody know about the cat pictures? Yes, go ahead. What's your name? Victoria, what's the...
Can I say it? He's got a photograph and he's sitting with his two cats.
Oh,
and
that's enough.
Another word for cats.
Yes, he says another word for cats. Okay. Yeah. So we all know that. Anybody here know how many followers he has on Twitter? How many followers he had before Twitter? Let's have a big group hug. I love you guys. I can tell you that everybody who's at TMZ is giving you the number, screaming it at the television. It was about 44,000. He's becoming super, super popular. I think that's fantastic. Can anybody tell me about the Weiner coach porn star to lie? Can you tell me about that story? You guys are the best. I love you. You are answering exactly the right way. Daniela.
I do know. He had some contact with a porn star, and he said, well, I'll give you my PR person to, I'll tell you how to cover this up.
Mm-hmm. You knew that. You knew that. You're shaking your head. Don't be afraid to answer the question. Weiner says a government phone for phone sex and the single mom. Does anybody know the single mom story? It's fantastic. We're going to play a little game I like to call Newsroom. We're going to play that here, America, next. Newsroom, you tell me which story should be on the air and why it makes a difference. Come on, let's go. All right. Hello, America. I have to tell you, I am proud to be built like a big bag of marshmallows. And I'm happy about it because it makes it very easy for me to resist all the women that don't throw themselves at a big bag of marshmallows. Little interest is paid to a guy like me. But then again, you got Anthony Weiner. And you would think that little interest would be paid to a guy like him. But apparently not. There seems to be a dirtbag circle out there. I actually said on the radio today, and I know a lot of people will probably disagree with this, but I said on the radio today that I feel bad for Anthony Weiner I have compassion for Anthony Weiner. I don't know what trap he fell into, but one of them is the internet. And the internet and porn and chat rooms and all these things is a black hole. And the internet is both the best thing in the world and the worst thing in the world. And you're going to be sucked down into that black hole. Or you can go to you can find any book in the library. You can find anything, any piece of information instantaneously. It is both good and bad simultaneously. It's what you choose to make of it. So he chose incorrectly. He went the wrong direction. I want to play a little game, Newsroom, here. If we can put two headlines up and you tell me, if you're the newsroom director, which one you put up. Can we put these up, please? Tiffany is saying 1-1000, 2-1000. Here it is. You have it? There it is. Okay. The latest picture of Congressman Weiner. Has anybody seen the picture of him bare-chested there with the family pictures behind him? Isn't that classy? Oh, man. And I love the way he said in his apology yesterday, it was just a joke. Oh, I bet his wife and family are laughing. All right, so here it is. You're the news director. Which one do you put up? The latest picture of Congressman Weiner or the housing market of 2011 being worse than the Great Depression? Which one? B. B. You put B up? How many say B? Okay. Remember, you're the news director. This one doesn't get you any ratings or sell you any newspapers. It's nothing. This one everybody wants to see. Who puts B up? Okay, we've weeded out about half of you. Come on! Okay. B is the one that we should put up, but that's not the one that's put up. Next one, please. Revealing details about Weiner's women. Something everybody wants to know, apparently. Or B, the revelation that Geithner doled out billions secretly to his favorite banks. B. Does anybody know this story? No. You don't know this one? Well, this is great. Here's Timothy Geithner. Timothy Geithner is our Treasury Secretary, of course, and he's completely clean. Doesn't know how to pay his taxes, but he's completely clean. Timothy Geithner went and he gave loans to some of his favorite banks at a special interest rate. Now, I don't know if you guys can't pay your credit card, do you get a special interest rate? No, yeah, of course you do. You pay 18, 25, 40%, you'll get a special interest rate. He worked out a special interest rate for his favorite banks, and it's 0.01%. Your tax dollars, what is it, $80 billion? Okay. But the news department all around the world decided to go with this one, not this one. But this one sells, this one doesn't. One more. Do we have one more? Pictures of Weiner's chest. Or China pumping big money into Latin America for oil, food, and minerals. Can anybody tell me about B? Can anybody tell me that story? Anybody know it? Nobody? But you can all conjure up in your head Weiner's chest, can't you? Yeah, it's good, isn't it? Can anybody tell me any of these stories over here? Dollar falls on China comment, stocks rebound. This is right here. Dollar drops to one-month low on recovery concerns. Dollar falls on China comments. Does anybody know what the China comments were? China, this is this week, this weekend. Friday came out. Yes, ma'am? In the back? Or, yeah, you here. Go ahead.
97% of the T-bills, they converted to longer-term bonds.
97% of the T-bills that were short-term, okay, which means they were just putting their money in there for short-term, 97% of them are gone. China's like, I'm going to get out of that whole short-term business with the United States. Good or bad? Good or bad? Bad. That's why the dollar falls. Stocks rebound. China official says U.S. could pursue weak dollar policy. What does that even mean? Anybody want to tell me what that means? Yes.
Weak dollar policy would be when the U.S. devalues the dollar a little bit in order to boost demand for trade. The problem is it basically steals money from the rest of us.
How does it steal money from the rest of us?
Our money is now not worth as much as it was. It's basically a tax since the government has the printing press.
How do you mean it's a tax for the I'm playing the person who's just, we're just looking, I'm sorry, they're now at their computer and they're like, wait a minute, the Weiner chest is really interesting, but what? They're stealing money?
Our money is now worth less because I can buy fewer goods with it. But the government that can just print more money doesn't feel that because the government can just print more money. If the government gains based off my loss, that's a tax.
They're causing inflation. You can't buy as much. Takes more dollars to buy the same thing. So inflation, prices are going up. Weak dollar prices or weak dollar policies. Chinese officials say U.S. could pursue weak dollar policy. Basically, inflation. Do we have inflation now? Yes. China pumps big money into Latin America for oil, food, minerals. This is the one that we just went on. Look at the one underneath it. China official sees risks in holding excessive U.S. assets. Why? Why? And China buying European food companies. Just put those together in your head and look at these. U.S. home prices, the lowest since the Great Depression. How Great Recession could still turn into a Great Depression. Anybody read the story this week that we're not headed for a Great Depression? We're now headed for a Great, Great Depression? Long-term unemployment worse now than the Great Depression. Geithner and Goldman are thick as thieves. Dollar drops, one-month lows, recovery returns. And the president says that we've hit a few headwinds. Okay, can anybody tell me, we look at these individual stories. Here are all the Weiner stories, and here are all the we're screwed stories. Tell me, what is the Weiner story? What does the collection of Weiner stories tell us? What'd you say?
People would rather look at
at junk?
The horrific stories that
okay.
Excites and titillates.
Christina?
That we're entertained to death, almost.
That we're entertained to death?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Watch the other hand? What does that mean?
Meaning, pay attention here, and while you're not looking, we're gonna do what we want.
Okay. Yeah, Jordan.
They'd rather watch someone else suffer than learn that they're suffering too.
That's really good. They'd rather watch someone else suffer than realize that we're suffering too or they're suffering too. Anything else? Marion, way up in the back, and we have to move these mics quickly.
The American idealization of trivia to the point where nothing serious can penetrate the nonsense.
Wow. I think these are all great. Cakes and circuses. Cakes and circuses. Give them cakes and circuses. You familiar with that? Essie Cobb.
Hey, boss.
How are you?
Good.
Good. Cakes and circuses. What's it from? Do you know? Anybody? Yes, Jesse.
It's how the emperors used to control Rome, by giving the people food and entertainment while the empire was falling apart.
Cakes and circuses. Think of this. Given the cakes, can anybody give me an example of cakes being handed out by our government? Can anybody handle that? If you're the emperor of Rome, you gave people cake. Well, we're not giving people cake now, cakes, but food. Food stamps. You want to control the people, the emperor knew, give the people cake, and then entertain them. Isn't it interesting how entertainment. We're not really. Really. What difference? What are you going to do about this? What are you going to do about Weiner? Anybody have a. Okay, that's probably a wrong thing to say. What are you going to do about that story? Get all mad? What? What are you going to do? You going to call him? Hey, you should resign. Well, that's going to help. What are you going to do? Seriously. Nothing. You're going to what? I'm sorry, Todd, what?
I mean, it's sort of amusing in its basic sense. You know, I mean, you look at it, it's like an inquirer mentality. You look at it and you're amused by it, but nothing ever happens of it.
But is it really funny? I mean, we're laughing because there's nothing else we can do, right? But it's not funny. It's horribly, horribly tragic. Here's a guy who has just put our country on the ropes. Why do I say he's putting our country on the ropes? Endangered each and every single one of us. How? Why? He what?
He could have been blackmailed and he could have given different things to different people because he was being blackmailed.
Extortion. His wife is like this with the Clintons. You're telling me there's no foreign interest in getting someone near the Clintons or getting somebody, you know, close to even anybody in Congress or blackmailing for information? You're telling me that that man didn't endanger the lives of his wife, didn't endanger the lives of people around his wife, people around him, people of Congress, information of the United States? You're darn right. Look what he did. For 3, 4, 5 days, he looked people right in the eye and said, I didn't do that. I can't say with certitude that's not me. I can. I can tell you right now, there's no pictures like that of me. Thank goodness, fall to your knees and thank God tonight. He couldn't do it. We laugh because what else are you going to do? Yes.
Personally, I don't really mind
that whatever he did, you know, what I mind more about is that he just came out and told the American people that it wasn't, you know, that he didn't send anything and he lied to everybody. And then a few days later, he says that it was him, and now all of a sudden, you know, it's supposed to be okay. If we can't believe him as a person, how are we going to believe him as a politician? So that's my biggest problem with him.
Yes, go ahead, Jesse.
Yeah, I mind what he did.
Good for you. I do too.
In the first place, it was horribly immoral. In the second place, we elect representatives because we trust their judgment, because we can't be there in Congress ourselves every day to make decisions. This was really, really bad judgment, and a member of Congress shouldn't have that bad judgment.
How can you trust a guy, is it Cheney?
Shani. Yeah.
How can you trust a guy who's in Congress who says, wow, I've been screwing around on my wife, and I've done such bad job. I'm so stupid. I'm this important. You know, I'm on TV. Everybody knows who I am. I'm in Congress. I've got political enemies everywhere. And I'm sending pictures of me with my cat and my shirt off going, dig me. That's how bad his judgment is. So, A, how can you trust him when he says, oh, no, you know what? Healthcare, I've looked into it. It's good. Really? Oh, okay. How can you trust him when he say, you know what? No, I'm telling you, this is we have to go to war. And how do you trust that this guy hasn't been compromised and compromising all of our information? It does matter, doesn't it? Yes.
The lying really bothers me. It certainly was terrible what he did. But when a witness takes the stand and an attorney shows that that witness was lying, the question comes, well, are you lying now? Were you lying before? You know, they're useless. They're worthless once you can prove that they lied. And my question is, if we weren't able to prove that it was a lie, how long would that lie have gone on?
Okay. So when we come back, you said something to me right before we went on the air.
Right.
You said that how many people even care about morals and what's morally right. Can you restate that?
Yeah. Basically, we always talk on the show about good and evil and morally correct. And just there's a lot of people that are kind of like in this little bubble, and they just don't care or don't even really know about what's going on in the world. Everybody's just kind of focused on their day-to-day, and nobody really looks at the bigger picture. And that's the real big problem. It's just like there's a whole group of people that might even be comprised like a majority to some degree that are just kind of go with the flow.
When that happens, cakes and circuses, and when people say, I don't really care, I'm just watching, it's just entertainment, they control. Whoever wants power, well, it could be anybody. Whoever wants power controls you. So now we've taken a look at the Weiner list. Now let's take a look at this list. And what does this picture mean? And why is that list important? And then I'll ask the same question. Okay, so then what are you going to do about it? Why even pay attention to it? What are you going to do about it? Next. Hello, America. Welcome back. We have an audience today because we have all these Weiner facts we have to sift through. In case you just joined us, the Weiner fun is over for a while. Now we're going to go to this chalkboard, which are the other headlines. There are more headlines here, and I love these headlines here. U.S. funding for future promises lags by trillions. You read that headline? Lags by trillions. In other words, Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security. We're now 61.8, but who's counting? Might be $7 trillion behind. Can anybody give an idea of how much money that is? You take every dollar, every yen, everything that anybody produces, sells, buys, anything, for an entire year, not in the United States and Canada and Mexico, but the entire world for a year, it's about $55 trillion. That's how far behind we are. Who thinks we can pay for that? Who thinks we can come up with a flying car that's going to pay for that? Nobody. Then James Carville said this: there will be civil unrest over the economy. Tiffany, do you have the actual quote from him? The civil unrest on the economy? Anybody see this? Yeah, of course not. He's on a network. Nobody watches. He was talking about it, and he said, civil unrest is imminent. It's imminent. Who thinks civil unrest here is imminent? Why?
Everything is just so crazy. And just look what went on with the protests for the,
Wisconsin? Don't
yes, be nervous. Wisconsin.
Just you, me, and 2 million friends.
And just, you know, you hear people, the sense of entitlement. Like, I was going to make a comment about the Weiner thing.
Uh-huh.
It's like it's being dismissed. He has no responsibilities. What is this? It doesn't make any sense.
This is a poor choice.
How are we? This is what we're teaching our children. It's like an entitlement society. Mm-hmm. That drives me crazy, and I get scared, because.
Don't get scared. Be determined. Don't be scared.
Okay.
Be determined.
But
yes.
We're going to be like Greece. I mean, that's what Greece. I see, and that's what I'm afraid of right now.
Who watched this show 2 years ago when I held up the book, The Coming Insurrection, and said, "Here it comes. It's coming. Read this book." Anybody remember that? Yeah. Called a lunatic. Hey, look what's happening in Greece. Yes, go ahead.
We've overspent. We've overpromised. We continue to spend. We're not cutting back anything. And we have a millions of people. Is it, what, 40% of the country that's on entitlements?
Yeah, is that a problem for you?
Well, what are we going to do when everything goes awry and bankrupt? What are they going to do?
Yeah.
Somebody's going to be upset.
Okay. All right, that's a good place. So, what are they going to do? What are they going to do? Question is, what are we going to do? What all these stories tell us, not the Weiner stories, the other stories, the stories that I showed you that China is, I mean, that story about China, Latin America, and Europe, they're buying the food manufacturing plants. Remember when I told you that food prices are going to go up? Okay, food prices going up. Anybody shop? Are food prices going up? Yeah. Anybody knows? The president said there's a food shortage. You know, there's going to be some food shortages around the world, et cetera, et cetera. Then we had all of the floods. We have fires that are going on. What's happening in Europe? Anybody tell me what's happening in Europe with the food? E. coli. Have you seen the videos of the giant, the green beans and the cucumbers and everything just being bulldozed and, right? What do you think that's going to do to food prices? Right? Okay. So when you look at all of these stories, the dollar is going down. Unemployment is high. We've got imminent crisis of, people that are going to riot, according to James Carville. Future promises lag by trillions. Food prices are going up, et cetera, et cetera. Answer the first question. What do the stories tell us? Yes, ma'am.
Perhaps we better start preparing ourselves with storage of food.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, perhaps we should prepare. For what? For what? The stories tell us, you cut right to the chase. But the stories tell us trouble is coming. Now, the next question is, what is the answer? Prepare for trouble. What would you do as a president? What would you do if you're president of the United States and you came to those two conclusions? What do those stories tell? Hey, there's trouble coming. The United States is bankrupt. The world is on fire. There's food shortages coming. We have energy shortages now. You're president of the United States. Anybody, what do you do?
Stop spending. Stop making promises you can't make. Stop printing money.
Okay? Yes, ma'am?
Fiscal discipline.
Fiscal discipline. Christina?
You warn and you tell your people to prepare.
Stand up and say this. You look at everybody and say this. What do you say?
You warn your people and you tell them to prepare.
You warn your people and tell them to prepare. Have you heard anybody say that in Congress or in Washington at all? I warn you, prepare. Why do you do that? You do it because it's your job to protect and defend the Constitution of the United States. We're going to start there next. We're with a studio audience today because it's a Weiner show today. And instead of talking about Anthony Weiner and the mess that he's in, and I know a lot of people want to see about Anthony Weiner, I think we might want to stop with the cakes and circuses for a second and say, okay, how does that affect my life? We've already seen that it affects our life, that he could be endangering all of us, because he can be blackmailed because of it. We know that it's a sad, tragic story with his family. And we've also decided there's nothing we can do about it. We can call. We can, I guess, protest. We can not vote for him. We can go vote for another candidate. But really, there's nothing we can do about him, right? Then you look, but that's the one that everybody does something about. Then you look at the other stories that we were showing you just a few minutes ago, and these were the stories on, you know, the economy and the, you know, China and what they're doing and devaluing the dollar, the Fed, et cetera, et cetera. And I asked right before we went into the break, if you're president of the United States, what do you do? The answer was, you would warn people and tell them to prepare. What would you tell them to prepare with, for, how? What'd you do? How would you do it? Tell them to prepare. Food prices are going up. Buy some food. Have some food. Make sure you're not behind the eight ball. How about make sure that you're not over your head if you can. You know, pay down your debt. Pay down your house as much as you can. Have extra in your silos, right? That's what you would do. But remember, you're the president of the United States. What's his number one job? What's he supposed to say when he takes the oath? Protect what? I'm sorry?
To defend and protect the Constitution.
Protect and defend the Constitution of the United States of America. Okay? So warn the people to prepare food, water, shelter, debt, whatever else you could think of. Okay? I think also, if you're worried that there's real problems in the world and our way of life is at stake, who thinks our way of life is at stake? Okay, our way of life is at stake. If I'm the president of the United States, what does Al-Qaeda do? Al-Qaeda, the reason why they're successful is because you cut off the head of the snake and another one pops up. I tell every one of my citizens, know the Constitution, know our history, know our founding. Because they want to cut us off, you want to pop up a problem over here, the whole thing doesn't collapse because the people know it, right? If you're president and your responsibility is to do that, don't you also say, read the founders, know the documents, do these things, do this. Man does not live by bread alone. You're president of the United States. Don't you say that? They all have. I know it's politically incorrect now, but they've all said it. We've all always believed we were a nation that, you know, was founded through divine providence. Don't we say, hey, you might want to check in with the spirit. Make sure you're cool. Is this the president's job? Is that the president's job? I contend it is, but I contend it's somebody else's job. Yes. The question is, why? Why do we wait around for permission? Why do we wait around for someone else? Somebody wrote a really great question today about Connor. Where's Connor? Connor, you're from what university? Fairfield University. You remember the question you
asked? Yeah, I asked you how do we protect ourselves from things that the government won't protect us from?
What are the things that the government won't protect us from?
Well, inflation for one.
They're causing it.
We could argue terrorism.
Right. Well, there are some things that the government has to do. They won't. So then what do you do? What was the secret of the Constitution? What was the secret of the Constitution? Why do you have the Second Bill of Rights? The Second Amendment, the Bill of Rights?
To protect ourselves.
To protect ourselves. What does that imply? Forget about the gun thing. What does that imply?
That we have the right to protect ourselves.
And you are the one in charge. You are the guardian of liberty. It's your country. And too many people, going back to your statement earlier, too many people don't care. They're watching this like it's a game, cakes and circuses, whatever, and they don't care. Okay. Well, you know what? Well, I ain't going down without a fight. How about you? The way to fix this is to fix those things. Tell people to prepare. And you do it yourself. If everybody in your family says you're crazy, believe me, you don't even know. Nobody can call you crazy in your family more than my family calls me crazy. Who cares? You know what everybody got in my family for Christmas? 6 months to a year's worth of food. I have family members that didn't even call me to thank me. Okay? No big deal. I knew they wouldn't. Because I knew they would get it and they would make fun of me. Oh, well. You know why I did it? Because I love them. But second of all, so when they call me and they're like, oh my gosh, I can say, yeah, I already did my part. I helped you out. Can't help. Too late. Now you're going to have to help yourself. That's what you need to do.
Off the Ferris wheel, I guess, like, because they like the circus. They like that idea, and they don't know sometimes.
How do you help them get off the Ferris wheel? I've given up. I really have. I've given up. I've given up on the people who you're just not. There are going to be people who just want to ride the ride. There are people that just like the game. How many people, SE, you could probably answer this, because you know a lot of I stopped talking to politicians.
What are you trying to imply, boss? That I like the Weiner stories?
No. You talk to politicians.
I do.
Okay, so you talk to politicians. How many of them are just in it for the game?
Oh, absolutely. And someone else mentioned it earlier. There is an entitlement aspect to politics now that didn't exist. And you know more than anyone. President George Washington was embarrassed to have two inaugural balls thrown in his honor. There is no embarrassment in politics anymore. There's no dignity. There's no sense of decency or honor. And the fact that we can all watch something like Anthony Weiner happen and laugh means we've lowered our standards too.
We have. So now, forget about the people on the Ferris wheel. Just say, oh, you're gonna ride the Ferris wheel? Have a good time. You're gonna be so sick, you're gonna be barfing all the way home. Well, had too much cotton candy. Me and my family, we're moving on because we have to protect it. Back in just a second. All right, so now here's what I've done. SE, do you know any of these guys?
I don't.
Okay. SE, she hangs out at colleges a lot, and I think Anthony Weiner does too, but that's...
You cannot say that and not explain what you mean.
Well, you're not with him.
Okay.
At least that I know of.
No,
you're
not.
Okay, all right. So she goes to colleges for a completely different reason.
Totally different.
You go to colleges too.
I speak to conservative students and hope to answer a lot of their questions. They're sort of
feeling alone.
Stuck out there in the weeds.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Now, here's what we're going to do. You guys go to, do you guys know each other? I mean, generally speaking, they're all college students up here, and they're looking terrified.
Thank you.
Don't worry, I'm just going to spring this on you real quick, and you're going to get about 2 minutes to complete the job. What I'm looking for are the comparisons of the 1930s and 40s to today. Does history repeat itself? Show me the comparisons. Come on, you guys are some of the best universities around the country. Show me the comparisons, and you just write them up on the board, and we'll watch and either point and say,
judge.
Wow. Yeah, we'll judge. Thou shalt not judge? No, not this time. We're judging the snot out of them. So look, and don't, where this is an imaginary, this chalk line is an imaginary line that apparently they can't see the other side of
the board. They're competing against one another?
Okay. Well, yeah, I mean.
Nice.
Yeah. I mean, is it, I'm wondering, we'll talk like in our golf voice.
Okay.
I'm not sure if either of them will realize that really all I'm going for is communists, national socialists,
right,
and fascists.
Right. It's that simple.
It's really that simple.
Yes. They're working hard.
They're working hard. I haven't seen
too
any
hard.
Of it. They're working way too hard.
Way
They're
too
overthinking.
Hard. They are.
They are overthinking.
Like students do.
Yeah, I didn't. No. I didn't. I never overthought anything. And maybe that's why I am where I am.
Right. Yeah. Well.
Yeah. On my way out of a very successful show.
Right.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes. All right. You got about 30 seconds because we're bored to tears over here. Anybody? Anybody? Here. Well, now as seasoned adults. Anybody tell me things that they're? I know. Can anybody tell me what you would put up here? Government regulations is one.
Failed socialistic policies.
Wait, what's this?
Failed socialistic policies.
Oh, failed socialistic policies. Anybody else?
Morals.
Yes.
Do we say gold standard? Off the gold standard?
No, not off the gold standard for the United States, not until 1971. Anybody else? The Dust Bowl.
Hatred for Israel and not Israel for the Jewish people at that time.
Good. Let's see what they have. Okay. All right. Time's over. Let's see what you guys have. Stock market double dip. Okay. Inflation. Anti-Semitism. Unemployment, food shortage. What do you mean, food shortage?
It's impending.
You go ahead and hold the microphone up.
Oh, it's impending.
Impending food shortage. Somebody else said Dust Bowl a little while ago. Did anybody get the Dust Bowl? Okay. Government expansion. What do you mean by government expansion? Who wrote that? None of you are taking credit for it.
FDR had the New Deal, and we have Obamacare now, and we have stimulus as well.
Okay, so would you say this is excessive regulation? Same thing?
Yeah.
New Deal stimulus, okay. Entitlements, inflation, unemployment, financial instability, excessive regulation, tyrants abroad. Who wrote Tyrants Abroad or who said that one? Yeah, go ahead. Tell me about that one.
We have tyrants.
Yeah, you didn't need to. Yeah. It's all right. Okay. I know it's a weird thing.
We have tyrants abroad in part in parallel to their anti-Semitism. We were thinking about Iran. We were also thinking about potential dangers from China. They're not a democratic
Good.
Government yet.
Okay, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back. Thanks, guys. Back with that thought when we come back. Quick, just want to finish up. Does history repeat itself? The answer is yes. If so, should we learn from it? Yes. Otherwise, we're doomed to repeat it. You just said about all of the different things. So you had two college groups come up, and they just outline all the things that are parallel. And you're right, all of them. One thing is the National Socialists. That was Germany, the Soviets, and the Communists. That was Russia. Fascism in Italy. Free Republic was the U.S. and the U.K. They were strong. U.S. is essentially strong. The National Socialists, now, they already have, they just in the Middle East, in Egypt, just established in Egypt, the Nazi Party, the National Socialist Party. It's Islamo-fascism. Remember, it's fascism, but it's socialism. The communists were in Russia, but they were revolutionaries. They were all over Europe, and they fought against the National Socialists, and they also fought against the United States. that they still exist. Many of them are now being taught or being taught or teaching in our classrooms. But the revolutionaries, that's what's happening in Greece. It is the communists that are doing it in Greece. Fascism is Italy. What is fascism today? What is the happy fascism? Because remember in the 1930s, everyone said, Italy, Mussolini, that's the new direction. Where are you hearing? What is the new direction for America and the free world today? It's China. It's repeating. The difference is the United States, where are we? We must stand up and stand together and learn from history, or we'll be doomed to repeat it. Back in a second. I want you to stay in touch with me this summer. Much is coming, much is happening, and I want you to stay in touch. Go to glennbeck.com and find out how to do that. From New York, good night, America.